Take me over the mountain to the valley way below, where my mother and daddy lived so long, long ago. I want to see the place I left behind, thinking I'd be free, but a life of pain and sorrow, Lord.
It's a beautiful day here on the homestead. This week we're going to talk about problems. Yes, there's always problems when growing a garden. There's bug problems, there's soil problems, there's watering problems. Just about any kind of problem that can come up will come up depending on the size of your garden. Usually the bigger your garden, the more problems you'll have.
Hello and welcome back to the homestead. Hey, this week we're going to talk about diseases and bugs. I know that's not our favorite thing to talk about, but I'm sure it's something that once we see it on our homestead and our plants, it becomes priority number one. And it has for us. We've got a leaf curl problem on our tomatoes, only affecting one, maybe the nearby plant as of right now. That's usually transmitted by white flies. The disease is called the yellow leaf curl, and it just destroys the plant. The leaves start to turn yellow, they start to curl up, and there's different ways that this is transmitted. I think aphids can transmit it as well. Also, other insects can transmit it. We use neem oil here on our homestead. Now, there's lots of different reasons why you'll find leaf curl on your tomatoes. Most likely in this situation, it's a virus, the yellow leaf curl virus transmitted by a white fly, aphids, or some other sort of sucking or chewing insect. Environmental issues may be a problem, and also you may find it from herbicide damage. But we don't use herbicides on our property. But if you're having the leaf curl on your property and you're using some herbicides nearby, it may have drifted over unexpectedly and is starting to affect your tomatoes. Now, I've considered physiological or environmental stressors that may be causing the problem with our tomato. It could be from the excessive heat that we had last week. Last week it was hot, very, very hot, and I watered a lot. Could be from the excessive nitrogen, if indeed I put excessive nitrogen in the ground. I did add a little bit of steer manure to those holes, and in some of the holes quite a bit, just to see what would happen. But I don't think that that's what's causing it. I think this is insect driven. I found some evidences, some serious evidences of some aphids on a nearby plant. Probably around 10 or 15 yards away, we've got our Brussels sprouts, and the Brussels sprouts are just infected with aphids. Pretty much a loss as far as the Brussels sprouts are concerned. I've never grown Brussels sprouts before, and I know any kind of leaf here in southwestern Idaho that curls or rolls, you're probably going to end up with some aphid problems. The smooth leaves, like from the Swiss chard and from the cabbages, not so much. The aphids will get on those, but they don't really have a little spot to kind of hide underneath the leaf away from the sun in order to do their business, their nasty little chewing and sucking business. When the tomatoes are infected with the yellow leaf curl virus, you're going to see an upward curling of the leaf, and it's going to look like a little cup. It's going to be pale yellow, and this plant here is very yellow, or turning yellow. It's much more yellow than the other plants nearby. We do see some evidence of transmission of the disease to the nearby plant, but I don't think that plant is quite infected yet and maybe still has a chance. But we're going to watch it close, because if I see any more signs of that yellow leaf curl virus on this particular plant, I'm going to cull that one in order to keep this from domino affecting down. Now, in our garden, we've got lots of things planted close together. Something that I was trying to avoid, but habit and, of course, culture has forced me into that particular role. I think next year I'm going to do a little better with that. And I will have to say I didn't do so good as far as separating my plants out. My squash are close together. My tomatoes are close together. I have found some evidences of little insects on the plant, and I'm guessing that this is the yellow leaf curl virus affecting this plant. I will cull it. There's really not much more to do other than using the shears to whip this thing off at the base and then disposing of the plant. Not disposing of the plant in the compost, but disposing of it either in the garbage, which we're going to do, or burning the plant, which I really don't have a lot of room here, and getting a burn permit just to burn one plant is just not something I'm going to do. So what are we going to do about the problem? We're going to kill the bugs. That's going to be first and foremost to get rid of the diseases. The bugs spread the diseases unknowingly. What they do is they take their little sucker or their chewer, their teeth in other words, and they stick them into the plant. And the virus from them is transmitted into the plant through their saliva. That's the problem. They don't mean to. So what we're looking at is trying to destroy the bugs. We want to get the bugs, at least the numbers, down on our property. Neem oil is what we use. Neem oil is a beautiful chemical. It's really an extract from the plant that grows, or a tree that grows in India. And neem oil is more or less a hormone that disrupts the eating and reproduction pattern of the bugs. So it doesn't really kill them. Yeah, the oil itself can suffocate them. But what is left over, let's say that's in the plant, yes, it does soak into the plant. What is soaked into the plant and is chewed on or sucked on by these bugs, thereby sparing the bugs that eat these bad bugs because they don't chew the plant or suck the plant, those bugs, the bad ones, die because they forget to eat. It messes with their hormones. It messes with their brain. And that's what you want to do. This also breaks down very quickly. And that's the downside to neem oil, but also the good side. The problem is the solution. You don't want to eat all this neem oil. It won't hurt you, because in some countries they use it as medicine, the neem oil itself. But here on a homestead, we're going to have it sprayed on our plants. It's eventually going to break down with UV light and break down the soil. It won't hurt our worms. It won't hurt our ladybugs unless it's sprayed right on them. Now you got to keep that in mind. That's why we spray it late in the evening time, so we don't spray it right on the bugs, the good bugs themselves. You can use a handheld sprayer and spray it directly on the bad bugs, and that's okay, because it's not going to get on the good bugs that way, unless you see one, of course. But a broadcast spreader is what you want to use. Now you can store neem oil for about 2 years undiluted, but once you dilute it, when you've got some left over, just spray it on other plants that aren't affected yet. You can spray it on your grapes, you can spray it on your rhubarb, you can spray it on pretty much whatever you want to spray it on. And it'll also avoid having the powdery mildew. It's a preventative measure for powdery mildew and other diseases. So consider neem oil. And we're going to do a little spraying later this evening. But right now we're going to look at some other things here on the homestead.
So everything is growing up pretty good. It's about early July and everything is coming into its own. We planted, of course, all our squash and zucchini in the same spot, and we're having a few problems with squash bugs, but we are getting some zucchini, and things are starting to look pretty well. We have covered these plants with neem oil in order to try to eradicate, or at least reduce, the numbers of squash bugs that we're facing, but we have had a little bit of problem here and there with yellowing leaves, etc. The cucumbers are looking great, and I can see someone else thinks they look great as well. And that's always encouraging whenever we see these things moving around our plants. Our marigolds are coming in, and our green beans, our pole beans, are starting to do their thing. They're starting to climb up the pole and look a little more healthy, and maybe they'll pull through. But our bush beans, what we prefer to plant, are doing fantastic. And we haven't seen any tomatoes on these plants yet. And these are our brandywines. And the brandywines tend to be later, if I remember correctly anyways, later in the season in their production. Our eggplants still haven't produced anything, but they're looking pretty healthy nonetheless. And eventually we'll start seeing some fruit on those. We did have quite a few volunteers come up this year. And you can see even in our rows where we've had some volunteers, and we've just kind of let them go. They seem very healthy and are enjoying themselves. Flowers are always a delightful addition to any homestead. I don't care who you are, something about flowers just does it, right? So we made this rock bed here on the side of our berm, and just as a quick little test to see how things would grow here. We did have to add compost and topsoil to that because it sticks out from the berm a little bit. We wanted to get rid of the rocky, nasty soil full of the goat heads that are still really running the show out here. If you'll see some of the plants there growing. And we come out once in a while with a hula hoe and we take care of those. Now, past the compost area, we still need to put some wood chips down here. What we had before, and eventually what I'm going to do is a before and after. And most likely I will do it mid-season so that you guys can see everything in its full form and also see how things started off on this property a little less than 2 years ago. You'll see here where this pit, and I'll show you some before and after images of this pit later. This pit was dug out by a bunch of kids during the history of this property, and I've been filling it in slowly. And we enjoy this area because it is shaded, lots and lots of trees, and our property does extend over there to that particular fence corner. But what I really like is the year-round creek that's down here, and I keep wanting to try to set up something to where we can actually enjoy the creek itself. So where all the dirt went when they dug this pit is beyond me. I don't know. And what I'm going to do is basically level it off with a little slope and maybe put some pavers from where we enter from over there. Now, when they built the property years ago, this property is probably about 18 years old, maybe 16. On this side of the fence, they piled up a lot of piles of dirt. Let's get closer. And you can see here how the watering pipe that we've set up here is just kind of rolling along on the contour of those hills. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of that dirt and I'm going to take it back to that pit, and I'm going to level that off so that watering pipe sits flat and flush, and some of the backings of those little hillocks, I'm going to put some rock to support it and just give it some design and contour. Now along the back side here, on this side of the berm, we've got a little area that's pretty well weedy, not much grass growing. We've installed a sprinkler head here to kind of keep it watered, and we mow back here as well. I've been thinking that back here would be a perfect place to put berries of some sort. Come in with an edge along our fence line of rock to support the soil and also make a buffer zone, and then coming in a few feet over to build the edge of the row using rock and putting things like currants, raspberries, blueberries, or whatever else we can put. There's a lot of sun that hits this area. So we've gotten to a point on our homestead where we're pretty comfortable with the way things are looking. And what we are deciding to do, and we're contemplating this very seriously, is looking for another homestead. Not moving out of the state or even out of the area, but another place local in our community that we can purchase, either a piece of land that we can purchase, or we can purchase a home on an existing property or piece of land that we can actually do a lot more than what we're doing here on this little 0.63 acres. A lot of this acreage is down the hill where the creek is at back there. And a lot of that is unusable. On the other side of the fence is a barrier. It divides zones when you're considering permaculture. You have to walk a distance through the gate to get through those zones, and that tends to be more of a hassle than anything. Our gourd plants are looking really nice. They're filling out, they're looking good. That's all edged with comfrey, shredded comfrey, all that brown stuff, that mulch. It's all shredded comfrey. Over here, our gourd plants are doing just as well, pleased with them. Pretty much doing exactly what I thought they would do. Now I'm ready for them to get big and spread out and make me some gourds. The comfrey needs harvesting, and we'll eventually probably do that, most likely next week, and use the clippings around the homestead. So we are down one tomato plant, and that's too bad. But at least we've got all the other ones ready to go. Now on the side of the home, the tomatoes grown on this side look just fine. We've got some tomatoes growing. You can see up in here how they're starting to form. We don't have any on our other plants, but these are different varieties, and they're starting to do quite well. And you can see here that's a monster.
So that's it for this week on Back to the Homestead. Not a whole lot to report. Things are growing. Things are looking pretty good. We do have that little aphid problem on those cabbages, and we're going to have to take care of that. Most likely, we'll be spraying again in just a little bit with our neem oil. I like to use the concentrate. I like to use a water hose connected sprayer, but for those little bitty spots, just spray them with a hand sprayer. You'll be just fine. Now remember that you want to spray your neem oil later in the evening or early in the morning. Neem oil doesn't keep very well when it's been mixed with the water, so go ahead and shake it up good and spray other things like your grapes, your squash, your zucchini, your green beans even if you want to. Spray whatever you need to spray, and that way it'll keep different problems down, including that powdery mildew on your pumpkins like we had last year, if you'll remember. Now what I'm going to do from this point right now is I'm going to go ahead and start putting together a video on a before and after. I want to show you guys where we were, what we walked into, and how we're going to leave this property. We are thinking about looking at other properties, and we'll see how that goes this summer. We're not sure. But if we find something, we'll of course let you know. Until next time, we'll see you on Back to the Homestead.
Back to the hills, where the gentle breezes blow, where the cool mountain mornings soothe the body and the soul. I want to hear mama singing in the sweet by and by.
I made this.